present the first speaker now. Our first speaker is Rob Colbert. I think of Stephen Colbert all the time. And he's a student here in the Anthropology and Social Change Department. Most of the people in the ERIE community are East West Psychology students, so it's nice to have someone with an Anthropology and Social Change background. He also went to Naropa and founded a Psychedelic Alliance in Naropa as well. To read his bio here, Rob received a BA in Contemplative Psych in 2008 and an MA in Transpersonal Counseling Psychology in 2012 in Naropa. While at Naropa, Rob was an active member of Student Orientation Leadership, Student-Led Programming, and is a founding member of the Naropa Alliance for Psychedelic Studies. So if you're ever in Naropa, check that out as well. At CIIS, Rob is finishing his coursework towards a PhD in Anthropology and Social Change and is a member of ERIE. His studies span an eclectic mix of counseling psychology, spiritual models of social action, and scientific research. So we can have a big round of applause for Rob.
Substances prescribed by professionals taken recreationally or otherwise mentioned by clients, they're all considered in an integral and holistic model. Clients have access to a whole world outside of the therapist or the professional's control, so harm reduction is our first major consideration. You don't have to know everything, so don't be afraid to ask questions. You should try and explore your own knowledge about psychedelic use. It can also be a process to work with clients as well, helping inform both yourself and the client. It's important to know about the culture, the effects, and the outcomes of substances. So. you should also, it's important to seek peer group supervision, always, you know, relating with other professionals in the field. Working with clients at this intimate level allows for us to be advocates. We get to encourage sovereign control over of one's own consciousness. So harm reduction, reflection, insight, and integration will all be important interventions. So some history. Soma is traced to the Rig Veda. Copious amounts of this substance were used in various rituals. Knowledge of the ingredients actually become lost altogether, as later Indian rituals reflect expiatory prayers, apologizing to the gods for the use of a substitute. Amanita muscaria represents an entheogen that may be the origin of presents under a pine tree for Christmas. Shaman in ancient Siberia would drink the urine of reindeer who ate the cast of Amanita muscaria. This filtered out toxins, allowing the psilocybin to become ingestible. So mushrooms have been used all across the globe. It's the fungus among us. Our ability to track which are poisonous, which are edible, and which cause sacred experience has shaped many cultures and traditions. The alkaloids in iboga, group have been harnessed by many ways and traditions. It's offered as a sacred healing medicine in many tribes and cultures in Africa. Ayahuasca contains N,N-dimethyltryptamine, which is not active orally. Today, people typically smoke or inject DMT. However, ancient Central American shaman and healers discovered that the shrub prepared and served with the vine containing DMT would create the desired effect. So, I could go into all the logistics of that and how it works, but it's too important. What it effectively does is so even with limited legal avenues for scientific research, clinicians, chemists, psychiatrists, doctors, patients, and students have all established literatures on interventions, benefits, and tools that relate, and also established the relative low risk of addiction to psychedelic use. So research continues, and what I want people to take from this is that there are legal options for both clinicians and clients to participate and experience the benefits of psychedelic therapy. So investigative research into entheogens and other psychedelics has been carried out at medical research centers, hospitals, and universities. John Hopkins University School of Medicine has completed extensive research on active thresholds of psilocybin and the treatment of people with obsessive compulsive disorder. Independent clinics in Mexico and New Zealand provide research into clinical use of ibogaine, the ibogaine, for treatment of addiction. However, as a clinician, I feel sometimes there's a protocol of this research that's used to control studies. It's used to control it to show evidence of specific outcomes. However, these protocols sometimes create a sterile Western medical frame. So it can limit professionals' access to a more eclectic mix of therapeutic interventions. So what I want to offer, what I want you to consider as a clinician working with clients, this does not suppose that a therapist is actually involved in the administering. This could be applicable if you're working with someone who has considered use on their own, has used on their own, knows others who are using, or just want to have good information about entheogens and psychedelics. So our number one goal, of course, is client safety. Harm reduction and considerations of overall health are super important. Every one of you will choose how this looks through your own therapeutic lens. But it is important as a clinician to consider the different levels of a client's psychedelic experience. The community can both be the community at large, which might condemn or criminalize the use of substances, but it could also be more intimate levels of community at the client level. The client's level of use, the friends and use, the rave culture, the nightclub culture, things like that. So as a transpersonal counselor, we get to make use of these many facets of people's experience to reflect to them ways of change in their lives. So the therapeutic alliance at intimate levels of the client's experience is important, and that's what we can offer as embracing entheogens and psychedelics. So by using the transformative properties of psychedelics and integrating experiences, transpersonal and integral counselors offer unique relationship opportunities for clients that may have been shunned or excommunicated from other support networks. Once again, it's not about encouraging use, it's about encouraging opportunities for choice and opportunity. So setting and dose. Whether psychedelics have been taken or are being taken or will be taken, it is important to cover the concept of setting and dose. This was first coined by Dr. Norman Zimberg. His work includes studies with Vietnam vets with heroin addiction. Research showed that 88% of returning war vets did not become re-addicted upon return. So his work showed that set and setting impacted the experience before, during, and after the use. So this research is often used in dispelling the myth that some people have addictive personalities. Set, setting, and dose have become a three-pillar approach to psychedelics. There are numerous ways that people can work with these concepts, but before and after, both before and after the use of substances. So set, this can refer to a client's emotional preparedness for the psychedelics. Preparation for the encounter, getting set to trip for several hours, and if working in a clinical setting, to set up therapeutic goals, safety precautions, a timeline of events, and informed consent of the client. So when working with clients who are reflecting on past experiences, it's also important to explore how they felt set before their experience. Do they have emotional awareness before the encounter, their physical health, their relationships may have been impacted by that sense of being set or not, to be used for entheogens or psychedelics. So it is important for the, it is also important to name intent. So in Carlos Castaneda's book, The Active Side of Infinity, he's quoted saying, intent is a force that exists in the universe. When sorcerers, those who live in source, beckon intent, it comes to them and sets up the path for attainment, which means that sorcerers always accomplish what they set out to do. Setting is the space or spaces that people will encounter under the influence of entheogens. Sometimes these spaces are sacred, intentional, or ceremonial. Sometimes they are random, contrived, or institutionalized. So setting can have a major impact on someone under the influence of psychedelics. Places where people feel safe, they can relate to others around them, and can also have room to make themselves feel comfortable and important. Setting is where relationship networks are built, both with people and objects, and they can be both physical and non-physical. A person experiencing entheogens in a remote jungle will garner different feedback from the setting than someone in an electronic music festival with thousands of people. So it is not about judging which one is better, but it is about discovering safety, intention, and choice within settings. If working with a client who has past experience, negative set or setting experiences, you can work at helping the client uncover the impact of those experiences and what it could have been like had it felt safe or positive. So this hopefully will be offer beneficial insight for the client. Dose. So users should also know what they are taking, how they are taking it, and how much they are going to be taking. They should be aware of dangerous levels of chemicals or interactions with other substances in their body. So many factors contribute to the outcome of entheogens and psychedelics. Sometimes drug culture gets caught on heroic doses. It is important to remember that sometimes a little goes a long way. And with that, the less often we experience something, the more special it is. So it's important to know everything you can about what someone has or is or might be taking. So harm reduction begins with researching information regarding not only the use of precautions, but also the substances used in changing mindset. So to offer a theoretical framework, Stanislav Grof offers a theoretical framework for working with persons under, using psychedelics. Specifically, this was developed in research with LSD. He describes levels or types of LSD trips and corresponding areas of human unconscious. LSD is definitely a psychedelic more than an entheogen. However, I think the framework is still applicable to a lot of the experiences. First level is the abstract and aesthetic experiences. They are considered the most superficial level of the experience. They do not reveal any unconscious subject or psychodynamic significance. So for a clinician working with someone during this type of trip, it is important for artwork, stretching, body work, breathing, and meditation exercises. Working with the client after the trip, it's helpful to let them reflect on some of the aesthetic experiences, but to allow them to let that expand into reflecting deeper, into deeper parts of the trip. So bringing awareness to the abstract and aesthetic can also be a way of calming someone from a bad trip or intense emotional experiences, but it should always be guided as relaxation and body awareness as is appropriate. The psychodynamic features, which Goff notes, are examples of the subject's experience. They might experience regression to childhood, even early infancy. Clients relive various psychosexual traumas and complex sensations related to infantile sexuality, and are confronted with conflicts involving activities and various libidinal zones. So because of the complex nature of psychedelics, their effect on time, space, cognitive function, and sensations, Groff uses a term for specific memory constellations called systems of condensed experience. These COEX systems, they epitomize and condense the individual's encounters with sensations, situations endangering survival, health and integrity of the body. They seem to be a summation of the emotions belonging to all the constituent memories of a particular time. I get the COEX system. I just prefer a Gestalt approach. Just for approaching the big systems of constituent memories, I would say. Each of us as clinicians will decide how we approach this with our clients. It's just described well in the psychodynamic language. So, next level will be perinatal experiences. They have a central focus on problems with biological birth, physical pain, aging, agony, disease, decrepitude, dying, and death. So this is where Goff suggests the use of perinatal phase birth matrices. It's a useful model, but not necessarily implying a causal nexus. The first stage is undisturbed intrauterine existence, cosmic unity. Second is the onset of delivery through feelings of universal engulfment. The third is contraction in the closed uterine system. It's the experience of no exit and the propulsion through the birth canal and death and rebirth strata. So, not that I don't fly through this. I do have references to that, but Groff found that the transpersonal experiences could also be considered innumerable simply because they are just that, they're transpersonal. So Groff offers material that he's found shows up in clients that have been working through the death and rebirth of the ego. He notes that transpersonal elements dominate all of subsequent LSD sessions of the individual. So he offers these realms of phenomenon, embryonal and fetal experiences, archetypal experiences, and complex mythological sequences, activation of the chakras, and arousal of the serpent team, or the serpent power from the meaning, consciousness of the universal mind, and supercosmic or metacosmic void. Groff notes that the psycholytic LSD sessions, all of his subjects sooner or later transcended the narrow psychodynamic framework and moved into the perinatal and transpersonal realms. So, of course, working with these experiences during a session will take on its own look and feel. However, clinicians might be surprised at how activated clients can become, even just recalling entheogenic psychedelic experience. The transpersonal can move a lot of emotion and energy for both clients and clinicians. So the Gestalt cycle of experience is very useful to help a client navigate the psychedelic realm either during or post-experience. It is also important to consider the interrupting or resisting process that can go on with each stage. So this cycle is useful because it holds a holistic view to consider what is present for the client first and foremost. It pays attention to contact boundary disturbances between the environment and the client. I don't want to go too far into this because it is complex. What I'd like to highlight, though, is a continuum of experience between the self and the environment that mobilizes sensation to excitement, to action, and to contact, reflection, and withdrawal. With this, we can see people cycling through it all over again. So that's something you can continue bringing up. So here are some reflections on the other important considerations. This is based on personal experience of my own and my own eclectic therapeutic choices. So, the paradoxical theory of change. A person does not change in their life by trying to become something they are not. They experience real change when they discover more of who they are. So allow permission for clients to discover more about themselves through the psychedelic experience, and expanding on who they are, how they are, or are not willing to contribute to change in their lives. Somatic experiences, encountered and expressed, can provide insight and growth for clients. Set and setting will both play both an important role in the emotional side of the trip, but is also paramount to the consideration of working with the body. So space to move and dance, relax and be peaceful are all important. Awareness and meditation practices, practicing to be here and now, breathing exercises, and body awareness can be important factors for the physical and emotional comfort of the client. So typically music with more rhythms, with less words is a good motto. Or if there are words in the music, suggest music which is directed towards positivity, community, celebration, and life. Harm reduction. Consider several levels of clients' experience, as well as different levels of cost and benefits of use. So make sure clients are informed with accurate information. Information coming from friends, parents, and media, and law enforcement, this may be limited in its view, and skewed on physical implications and reactions. So here's what I consider to be our choice in working with clients, and how we identify the relationship between them, psychedelic use, community, family, and the therapist. As transpersonal counselors, I believe we offer a little bit more for clients, either with experience with psychedelics or preparing to use. So, with all legal considerations taken, we can still have real intimate dialogue with clients about the impact, importance, or experience of psychedelics in their lives. There is so much research that has been completed and published regarding the safe use and practice of psychedelic therapy that we as clinicians can no longer ignore the impact this might have on the population we serve. So from working with conflicts, reflecting on the acid trip they took after their first one was born, to helping a closet opiate addict find an ibogaine clinic in Mexico, we have the opportunity to follow a harm reduction model and see psychedelic use for the potential of encounter and healing for individuals. Less is more speaks to moderation, reflection, choice, and control in people's lives. This philosophy emphasizes the benefit of not having to take a substance on a daily regimen to experience change, but the ability to experience change with very little exposure to substances outside the body. It is incredible to know that 83% of severe heroin addicts that have joined the ibogaine research have experienced relapse times spanning years instead of months or weeks, and when relapse takes place, have been more reflective on their experience, encountered less drastic falls back into the addictive behaviors and patterns. So it's not a cure, but at the same time, it's created many positive changes in people's lives. So much that their addictions no longer dictate their actions. They experience choice in the matter. So is it possible that less often we experience something, the more the experience will build meaning? What defines meaning, importance, and guidance in our lives? These are the things that we should consider for ourselves and for our clients. So I know I went through that, there's a lot of information, but what I want to do as well is I kind of wanted to explore, we have a lot of different professionals in the room, so I'd like to kind of just start a dialogue and see if there's any other therapeutic interventions that anybody has either heard of, has seen practiced, or used themselves.
There were a couple things just on the theoretical stuff before the application. Could I bring up now? One of them was this thing about when it seemed as though Groff's chart that you used, was he suggesting that it was like a hierarchy of experiences, being aesthetic, being the abstract aesthetic, being the most superficial? Was that his words? I'd like to challenge him on that and put out another alternative, if I could.
Because what I see... just the point where Groff was kind of positioning that was that... They're superficial in the sense as a clinician, I can't do a lot about the patterns. As far as work for the client, they can provide a lot of very very rich content. But as far as the exchange between the client and the therapist or the guide, it's not as beneficial.
Because of the limits the therapist has to deal with that kind of stuff.
Yes, and a lot of time bringing in like the cognitive awareness of those situations can really dilute
Correct.
What's actually going on. So
yeah.
It's important, that's why at those phases it's more important to let them free express through artwork, body work, stretching, being present with whatever's going on instead of worrying about like conveying what they're experiencing.
Okay.
So
I was thinking of it as a hierarchy in the sense of let's get beyond the aesthetic and get into the perineals. I like that.
Yeah. No, and
that makes sense.
You also wouldn't want to be rushing someone through.
Because the reason it touched the button for me was because I was getting into the aesthetic and the sublime and the art. And the artist experience, kind of a raw experience of getting into those places, and that was pretty rich as far as tapping into the unconscious without putting a lot of cognitive models around it. Raw contact, even from stuff I was reading about, some of the histories, some of the surrealists and all that. So, okay, thanks.
Well, and it should be pointed out that even when... even when working in the perinatal experiences or the transpersonal experiences, those are going to be abstract and aesthetic as well, you can't really separate that. It's more about the transfer.
Yeah. Thank you.
Can you say a little bit more about the paradoxical theory of change? You said that it's not necessarily that we evolve and we become something that we're not, and therefore evolve, but it's more like remembering what we are, or tuning into what we already are, and that propelling us to be what we are.
Yes. So simply, we don't experience change. Like I don't. It's paradoxical. I focus on changing. If I focus, let's see. Okay. So the person does not experience change in their life by trying to become something that they are not. Right? So you don't experience change by becoming something that you never be. The way you actually experience true change is by trying to become more of who you are. Exploring that. Real change comes when they discover more of who they are. So allowing permission for the client to discover more about themselves is better than I'm tripping on this because it's paradoxical. So expanding on how they are or are not willing to contribute to change in their lives will be more important than focusing on what they're not, what they won't be. Does that clarify at all, or is there more?
I guess the question comes because in my own search right now, I recently heard that at the end of the Bhagavad Gita it says, I remember. And so I'm connecting it to that in terms of my own spiritual development. I've always been trying to get to this place where I'm something I'm not, and therefore get enlightened. But according to paradox, it's not necessarily becoming something you're not, it's remembering who you are. And psychedelics can aid in that realization.
Almost in a sense, allow you to kind of sneak up on yourself. Like, wow, there I am. Like, how beautiful is that?
I remember Ellen Watts, I think it was, it said about that word shrink. Shrinking. This for the psychiatrist, and shrinking is to shrink the ego back to its appropriate size from the inflation. So that's a form of remembering something primordial.
Are there any other questions?
In your title, you mentioned pathogens and pathogens. Can you maybe explain for everyone what the differences are?
Entheogens specifically is used to describe substances which provoke a sense of the divine, communing with deities or other spiritual figures. The entactogens, this is more of an academic or kind of debate, just letters passed back and forth. But it is important to kind of flesh out the meaning. So the touching within, the entactogen, is about the experience. It's a very personal experience. It can be very introverted. And so that process can be very beneficial for certain types of work. Where the empathogen is on the other side, it's about connecting outwardly. So that's kind of where the distinction comes in. So we use that. And then the entheogen is less individually driven. It's more of maybe an experience, a universal experience, an experience of divine, you know, those kind of things. So.
Just to follow up, do you have one substance or medicine that could be an entheogen, an entheogen, an entheogen? Is our setting part of what creates that relationship? Or are there kind of like, this is specifically an entheogen, or this is specifically an entheogen?
Yeah, no, that's good. I do believe that there are substances that can kind of span all of them, and it depends. Also, you know, like I said, we're working with clients. Sometimes, you know, it's out of our control. They may have taken several substances, you know, so they may have done that as well. So trying to hold the level of like, okay, we don't always know those things, and whether or not it was an entactogen or a pathogen or whatever, but focusing on the level of experience and relationship relating to the other world. The sacred, so I find it important not to draw so much distinction, because sometimes there's a shaming if someone has had a very powerful experience and it wasn't in a sacred space. You know, if they find that it was sacred for themselves, they like to be built meaning around that, instead of, you know, trying to shift it and be like, well, you didn't do a ceremony. But I do believe that that harnessing ritual and ceremony intent in general can enhance the experiences. You know, so exploring that with clients, whether they're taking any of these levels, that we can, it changes it into medicine work instead of just recreationally.
From a layperson's perspective, as a user as opposed to someone in a therapeutic setting, would you say that your therapeutic model is directive, or do you set up some kind of, do you have an objective when you're using a psychedelic with a particular individual? Because those categories seem really fuzzy to me.
Yeah, because they are fuzzy. You know, someone on psilocybin, for instance, they may have very introverted periods and then very extroverted periods. You know, so you can do this movement in or out. So less about kind of defining what the experiences are, and more of a fluid movement of the person's experience, how they experience. It's about exploring change in their life, whether that's a change in perceptive of a past experience, like maybe they had a bad trip on something. You're just helping someone reflect and build on that instead of, you know, trying to guide it. So does that help? It's definitely less guided by a clinician or therapist, and more of a witness. It's definitely guided or witnessed, and less directed towards making it safer.
I noticed psychedelic therapy. At one point, that was differentiated from psycholytic therapy for smaller doses, longer term, more therapeutic, and the higher doses called psychedelic for breakthroughs on a mystical level. Do you have some idea? I mean, what is your? You're not including psycholytic. Do you have any reason that you think it's not a useful model?
No. I didn't make that distinction. In cross research, that is made apparent.
I think it goes before Roth.
He entered into that. I don't, and I do use, you know, psychedelics and entheogens interchangeably. And I believe that, I do have a feeling about that related to dose, that sometimes, less is more, for sure. And I do think that sometimes, like with working with clients, a lot of what I've heard people, the way they take substances or explore it, does have this like heroic dose mental, like, I gotta go for the whole grip of this to get a hold of it. And I don't know that that's necessarily valuable. I mean, in some instances, it is, but that's not like what you hear it towards that. So yeah, variation of dose, even at very low levels, can have all sorts of different outcomes. So yeah, when exploring that with clients or other people, that comes in with dose and just saying, okay, well, what is the intent behind this? You know, and knowing that, you know, at some levels, you may have just simply very somatic experiences. At other levels of substances, you will skyrocket into psychedelic or the divine. You know, so yeah, I didn't break that, but it is an spectrum.
Just clarifying
on
that.
The psycholytic in the research was broken down to smaller doses. When they first were using it, they were using real low doses. Rob's research expanded into using very high dose LSD sessions. And at the very high dose, they were experiencing the perinatal birth matrices, like reliving birth experiences. So it kind of went into the transpersonal. In that research as well, he also found that it didn't necessarily have to have substances, and so he went into the holotropic breathwork and essentially accomplishing that that break between our normal consciousness into the altered state or the non-ordinary, and there's all sorts of things.
Sorry, I can't even late, so I might have missed some aspects of it. I'm curious about, I'm also approaching it more from the client side, but a question that comes up a lot for me is the idea of vetting the situation, vetting the client, vetting the medicine taken, and I think when I read Secret Chief Revealed, there's a lot where he sort of talked about like making sure that everybody's coming in to it, from the right space, but I still feel like there's a lot that's being missed, when you read whoever, Prof. Femmes, whoever, where there's a lot of, I don't feel like there's enough talked about vetting the person and the client and the medicine in terms of like what's going to be the most helpful and the safest and I don't know. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sometimes there's control in that situation, and we can set up our intent. And then other times, we don't, like working with clients, right after New Year's is always interesting, especially when you're working with addicts and stuff, because you get to find out all the challenges or the relapses that happen. So, sometimes it's just like, oh, then there was medicine present, they took something, and that was the experience. So it wasn't a lot of time to like really ground in that. But it is, whenever possible, to bring intent into that feeling set, and recognizing that it's, you have to have compassion for yourself, occasionally, as a user or even as a therapist. Like, there's a lot of work that's possible in these spaces. And to realize that's really serious work to take on as an individual. It's like, it's not for the faint of heart,
Right.
So
it's hard to know. I mean, like, is it for me, that question of, how much fear are you supposed to face in anyone? You know what I mean? Give yourself over to it and breathing and okay, it's gonna be fine. And maybe I shouldn't have either done this medicine or put, and again, that dialogue, I'm speaking of it from the client side, but something for therapists to ask in terms of what makes the most sense for helping someone get to, pushing themselves, so to speak, or uncovering who they are without forcing this change that isn't something that they are already.
It's interesting. Just even the suggestion of using substances is like a hurdle to be like, okay, well, is this something to do or not to do? It really is. I try and as a counselor, I try and help support the exploration of that, and plenty of times I have come through the experience where we've prepared therapeutically, okay, well, if you are going to do this, what is it going to mean in your life? What is it going to mean after your use? These kind of things, and realized, oh, well, you know what? in this process, I've actually changed enough that I don't think I need to go out and use a substance or, you know, go do MDMA with my friends or this or that. So, yeah, it's on an individual level. During the experience, sometimes the fear that comes up is like, oh, am I taking too much, or not enough, or this or that, is part of the process.
Yeah.
Fear is something that we just have to work with. So,
I think some of it, what complicates it too, is the fact that because the substances are illegal and because the research is, you know, either buried or takes so much to, you know, with MAPS or whoever, there's such a ramp up to even get to doing research that we're all kind of reaching around, making it up as we go. I mean, yes, there's history behind it in terms of hundreds of years, but even also a handful of decades.
Mm-hmm.
But in a sense, each of us from both sides of the conversation are kind of going, you know, our best guess in a sense.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and just to be candid, you know, there's a long history of exploring these uses of substances, you know, I mean, yeah, it's been thousands of years people have used these. And so in our current climate, you know, it's actually a rarity for people like me to come up here and kind of out myself and say, hey, this is a real experience that I've had with clients. And I'm not going to demonize this or criminalize it. Like, I want to explore this as like an opportunity for choice, you know, for change. But yeah, it's you know, there's a whole underground community of people that just want to up themselves because the work is continuing to work as that part of the experiment.
You're talking about ibogaine and the treatment centers in the country. I wonder if you know of any numbers or even how is the experience for you, if you ever worked with anybody who came back to ibogaine centers, and is there a greater success rate with like post-experience for integration, for lack of a word, or the time to that like after experience? Is there any kind of numbers on that at all? Is there any kind of help that's happening on this side of that?
There are support networks. There are support groups. That have formed because, it is important to it's not just like you shoot down there, get popped up on some ibogaine and boom, done. It is a process. And there's people that battle with severe addiction. So it's not just like an easy, quick answer. So there's a lot of support that's needed. And regretfully, you have to find it through the support groups. You can't, it's not like you can go to the same clinic and see the same therapist. You'd have to travel, you know, or make extended stays. And I've heard of both, you know, people going down for just 2 week treatments, also staying for months, you know, and continuing the process.
Are there any numbers though? Like, is there anyone that's done any studies with the success rate for people going down to the ibogaine with no support afterwards, and the success rate with support? Or are there any sort of?
Oh, you know, I have not specifically looked into that research. I hope there is. MAPS lists a lot of their follow-up research, there might be something in there. Most of my experience with the iboga or ibogaine is just word of mouth, just talking with people who use it, and that's only one or two people, so haven't been able to kind of get that. But it's definitely interesting to talk to people who are like, my life is rock bottom, and just going down and spending 2 weeks to come back and it's totally transformed my life. You know, still dealing with life because it's rough, but you know, not shooting up this or that kind of work. So I don't know the numbers on whether people were getting support or better off or not. But it's totally
exactly,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
I'd like to hear your anthropological perspective on using cross-cultural models for ritual in psychedelic. For example, Native American peyote users in Canada, secondhand information from someone who was there, that menstruating women were prohibited from being in the same room because they were sloughing off their uterus and therefore personified negative energy. There are number of things that I have encountered over my 40 years of mucking around in this stuff, and I'm just curious about, do you have any comments or any thoughts about that?
It's interesting. Being in the Western culture, there's a lot of appropriation. I mean, it's rampant. And so Yeah, the misappropriation of ceremonies or rituals or even substances themselves. Adds its own kind of challenges to what we consider like the work, either as an individual or a therapist. For myself, what I've tried to work is helping clients, you know, find a community, and in that part of it is a community that your principles or the way you want to participate or practice kind of fall in line with who you are. So in that, you know, so back in, when I was in Colorado, I was speaking with a client who was going to, they were going to partake in an ayahuasca ceremony. She was of South American descent and grew up in the States and was prepared to go do this ayahuasca ritual and was hoping for something different than what she received when she showed up. It was a ritual that was very based in Catholicism and had these very strong aspects of the Trinity emphasized, and these things that it shocked the hell out of her. I mean, she was just like, wait, I thought I was going to be, you know, engaging in sacred medicine, and then somehow it was taken away. So in that, it was working to recognize, okay, so it wasn't what you expected, and it was more difficult. How do we expand on that and choose differently in life or build more support, know what we're getting into, you know. So we kind of get a mixed bag. We don't know where we're going to get. So it comes about preparing ourselves, being set, and exploring our communities. As far as like an anthropological stance, I see most of it as reappropriation. And you know, that can be both beneficial and really icky and oppressive.
Well, that goes also to your comment about the secret chief, which when I read it seemed to me interesting from a historical perspective and also very Judeo-Christian. Mm-hmm. The whole setting, the whole perspective and the way the trip was structured.
I have a question about, I might have missed this because I've been new to it, but I was wondering about the legal side of it for therapists and...
The ego side?
The legal.
Legal
side.
The
legal side, side about, you know, referencing these things that are legal and discussing them with them. What's the law around how a therapist, what a therapist can legally say and do around this legal side?
Well, yeah, it's always important to not suggest that people ever break the law. The ethical consideration there is you don't want to be suggesting things that could potentially harm someone. So most of the time, it's kind of just, you know, holding your professional stance and allowing that to come from the client. And you know, a good way is to be supportive of the experience, and just helping them explore that. And so, just speaking with someone who's facilitated for a long time, I said, well, you know, I will never tell someone they should do drugs. I don't do that. I might tell them what some of the benefits of doing drugs are, but I would never say that they should do them.
So it's all about semantics and how you phrase it in context.
It is. It's framing. And you know, this person that was sharing this information too said, you know, and they actually facilitated sessions where people were actively using. And I was like, well, what? How did you do that? You had to break the law to go buy a substance or something. I said, well, no. I let the client do that on their own. You know, they explored the medicine. They engaged their community. So in that, it was like just bringing up public safety, just being like, all right, you know, what? How are you going to explore getting this stuff? You know, and how to make sure that you're safe, and you know, because you know, you're potentially breaking the law. And I don't want you to.
There's no DEA surveillance or anything like that going on for therapists. I'm just thinking of in terms of.
Oh no, none whatsoever.
Yeah, with the DEA or FBI recently. it definitely depends on the different substances that are involved, the classification of how hard people are like enforcement agencies are pursuing that. But it is a place where investigations happen actively and people are fined and go to jail and lose their licenses.
To that point, is there a definitive listing of the jurisdictions where various substances can and cannot be used? I mean, cannot is pretty broad, but can. You say, if you want to take this substance, go to this country. If you want to take this one, go to this state.
So there are different social forums that will list those kind of things. I think Blue Light is a place where there's different, it's a drug positive forum where people can kind of explore that. And so a lot of times people are like, oh, you're specifically talking about, you know, getting over heroin addiction. We can actually suggest these clinics in Mexico or Canada. But as far as just like that being tracked, I don't know of it. It would be a rather large target. But it even differs by state. Because like here in California, the use of cannabis for use of anxiety or all sorts of things, it's legal, you know, but you go across into Utah or Nevada and it's not, it's actually discovered, you know. And then at the federal law, of course, it's a Schedule 1 substance, so it's illegal everywhere. So, just because it gets so messy, I don't think that anybody's really need a comprehensive list. There's a lot more lax enforcement in like European countries around certain substances, but then they also might be more strict on other ones. So, there's no problem.
Is there any country currently, I usually try to keep updated on this, but is there anywhere that there is legally sanctioned psychedelic psychotherapy, and I don't mean ceremonies and shamanic rituals or religious uses, but actual psychotherapy? Government sanctioned, I mean, they're allowing it. I don't think there is, right?
So New Zealand, Switzerland, Canada, sanctioned?
I don't know, Canada's great.
No, they just started kind of going to the radar. But New Zealand has identified the use and is active in the research and trying with that.
I mean, they're supporting, if there's therapists there that are using psychedelics in their therapy, they're supporting that therapy?
Huh. From the protocol.
I feel like I have a pretty good grasp with clients in the room on how to not suggest that they purchase or use drugs. I don't have a good sense of how to talk about my clinical work outside of the room in order to attract clients that want to explore those issues without putting myself in a legal or ethical murky middle ground. I feel like I'm fine once I've got a client in the room who's exploring, but you know, putting on the website, and if you want to talk about drugs, come on down, doesn't seem like the best. So I'm wondering if you have any feedback or suggestions or things that you've noticed other clinicians have done in their experience to attract that kind of client who wants to do that sort of exploration without making friends with the DEA.
Okay. I think that there's probably lots of different approaches. One that is pretty common is just word of mouth with your friends, you know, your peer supervision groups, just put it out there and just saying, hey, you know, if you have clients or you're clients, you know, just trying to expand that network as much as you can. Also, it comes into framing. There are ways to just package yourself as a drug-friendly therapist. You know, packaging the non-judgmental side and can offer a framework that people can kind of read and say, oh, I think they're saying they wouldn't judge me if I had, you know, been getting high anything, you know. So, the framing is the best way, I think, to approach it. As harm reduction, as therapeutic engagement. But there's definitely no easy answer on that. Disco lights and stuff.
Just to develop, I do know some clinicians, and what they do is they actually feel comfortable enough with their clinic to kind of get the word out within their clinic, because each of those clinicians have people coming in and they don't want to deal with it. It's like she's getting all these referrals from people that are talking to these other clinicians about the work, and she's trying to do that. So it's also another way. Also, one thing we're trying to develop on the website is to actually have a list of people who are supporting integration work. So people can actually use our website as the middle space. So if you'd like to check with us later as well.
Yeah, and just like you said, using integration, you know, transpersonal integration, you know, those kind of framings help a lot. that way it's less focused on the actual substance or use or exploring it, but more on complicated process. Any other questions, or anybody else?
So you were at Naropa for your therapeutic training. So what was the, Naropa's another cool school, what was the atmosphere, the attitude in the class when they addressed psychedelic and psycholytic psychotherapy? They talked about it, so were they encouraging, were you able to read an attitude behind that was delivered in the, was it open and encouraging? Was it neutral? Was it kind of shaming or regressive? What was your experience?
Well, to be fair, it was me who was talking about it.
That's great.
Boulder's an interesting spot, just like the Bay Area. The drug culture has a less of a conservative vibe. It's definitely more liberal. So just in that sense, it landed pretty easy in the Boulder scene, and then Naropa. I don't know if I'm regretful about it, but they have a long history of substance use and abuse. Exploring the positive aspects of it was great, just because there's been a lot of shaming of the history of culture and things like that. They have beat poets around, trying to become regular drink sake, you know, things like that. So there's this like underlying culture of like, yeah, this isn't good. So then at the transpersonal level, bringing it in and saying, okay, well, how do we package this differently? It lands better. People received it, but it also wasn't like promoted by any stretch. Naropa and CIIS are great places to be getting to this work, and it's still a challenge because there's a lot of people having to develop it.
Thank you.
What about other, are there any other interventions that people might have, for the professionals, that they might have used in the work that have come up to develop?
I have a question.
Yeah.
What about cannabis? I mean, do you use that? Do people who are looking for therapeutic modalities consider that one?
Yeah, and that's actually that's one of the entheogens that's been used for thousands of years, and just now is getting recognized in Western traditions. But actually, in Kashmir Shaivism, Lord Shiva brought marijuana hemp down from the Himalayas as a sacred gift to the people. So that connection with the divine is really rich in that tradition. So and currently research is being done with cannabis and the use of PTSD treatment for PTSD. Returning war vets. My brother-in-law has explored some of these treatment options, and he's just found that just not drinking and smoking marijuana instead has been paramount in his recovery. It's not that it's cured his PTSD at all, the symptoms, but he at least copes in a way that he's found more healthy for him and his relationships. That's it for me, then, if there's any other questions.
Thank you.